Hi, I'm Sister Bliss from Faithless, and this is the story of insomnia. How and why did Faithless form? That's a good question. I'd been making dance music. I met Rollo. We met each other in the record shop, Pure Groove in Archway, which was the epicentre of all things fabulous and dancey at the time. Anyway, we went to his place, watched Blade Runner, smoked a bit, went back to my mum's and made a tune. He said, my friend's a producer, his friend Ben. Rollo and Ben and I worked together a bit, and Ben went off to do various things. He actually then formed various bands, one of being LaRue. So he carried on moving and shaking. It was actually through Ben that we met Maxi. Ben announced he'd met a Buddhist rapper in Brixton through his girlfriend, a South London lass. And we said, oh, that sounds interesting. And we just discovered a button on the Atari that made the tempo slow down. That was quite exciting. Obviously, French Kiss, Little Louis, did it years before, but we were slightly technically chaotic and only just found that button by accident. Anyway, we slowed down, we had this house track and slowed down to a hip hop groove in the middle. We thought, wouldn't it be interesting to meet Ben's friend, Maxi, and see what he can do with it? And we thought, we'd never met a Buddhist rapper before. So we invited Maxi to the studio and we just talked long into the night about his Buddhist faith, what that meant to him, what it meant in the context of modern life. Because he's not an athlete in that he doesn't lock himself away like a kind of Zen Buddhist or a monk. He's really about living life to the full. From that conversation came the very first Faithless record, which was Salve Mea. And Rollo asked Maxi, like, what would you do if you were so uncomfortable you could barely live in your own skin? And Maxi proceeded to tell us about his journey to Buddhism, which is when he had no faith in himself and he was essentially faithless. That life was frustrating and difficult and, you know, led him to very dark places, and Buddhism was a bit of a salvation from that. Just changing his thinking and his perspective on the world changed his life quite radically. After we made that record, Rollo named the project Faithless because he understood that that was what Maxi was talking about, really. So that was the beginning of Faithless, and we were actually signed by Island Records for that record. And it just sat on the shelf for months. They just didn't know what to do with it. Was it house? Was it hip hop? It was a bit dark. It wasn't kind of hands in the air, happy house. So they weren't really sure where to put it. So, you know, we thought, we don't really make music so it can just sit on a shelf. And we had a clause in our contract that said we could get the record back if it wasn't released. So we got it back and decided, we enjoyed working together so much, should we make an album? Let's put some other music around this. And yeah, so that was the beginning of Faithless making our first ever album. It's quite hard to remember the process. It was in the garden shed in Islington, that's where Rollo's studio was, and then we mixed it in a nicer studio around the corner. It was called Swan Yard. It was quite a legendary place, and we used to get the downtime when the kind of big artists had finished in the day and we could book it a bit cheaper at night. But I think we did a lot of the demos in the garden shed. I certainly remember that we did Insomnia there. Like albums back in the day were on vinyl, they had an A side and a B side, and we needed a track to balance Salve Mea on the B side. And I can't remember if the groove came first. Often with me, it's a bass line. And I remember we wanted to go shopping because in Islington they had a record and tape exchange, and we always liked to, you know, rifle through the secondhand tunes and see if there's any like rare bits we could pick up. And I think we had a groove going, maybe the bass line came first, and then Rollo said, oh, just do a riff. I don't even really remember what instrument I played it on, but Rollo was the one that found a sound on a Roland keyboard called a JD-800, which is a really great bit of kit. In fact, we used to get quite a lot of sounds out of there before we moved into rack mount keyboards. And I just literally sort of sat there and jammed, as I always do, and that's the riff that came out. asked Maxi to write lyrics about getting no sleep, because at that point I was DJing loads and my sleep pattern, as most DJs, was just completely upside down, and I really couldn't get to sleep. So I literally marched into the studio and said, right, we're doing a tune and we're going to call it Insomnia because I can't get no sleep. And Maxi kind of went away and scratched his head and had a think about it. Yeah, ironically, he can sleep at the drop of a hat really, really well. Literally could sleep sitting up in that chair. But he did have an abscess on his tooth at one point, and he referred back to the agony of that and if you like, took himself back into that space. And that's where he wrote the lyrics. Yeah, I only smoke weed when I need to, and I need to get some rest. Yo, where's the sex? I confess, I burned a hole in the mattress. Yes, yes, it was me. I plead guilty, and at the count of three, I pull back the duvet, make my way to the refrigerator. One dry potato inside, no lie, not even bread, jam. The light above my head went bam. I can't see, something's all over me. Greasy insomnia, please release me and let me dream about making mad love on the heath, tearing off tights with my teeth. But there's no relief, I'm wide awake in my kitchen. It's black and I'm lonely. Oh, if I could only get some sleep. Creaky noises make my skin creep. I need to get some sleep. I can't get no sleep. And the first mix was a bit of a homage to Detroit. People don't really realise that. The Moody mix was the first mix before the Monster mix, which I think was the mix that took it to a place of sort of grandeur and widescreen, you know, epic vibes. But it was never meant to be a big sort of commercial hit. I mean, we were told initially that it certainly wasn't. When we took it to Radio One, we had radio pluggers, and they just said, it's got no hook, it's got no chorus, go away. And we re-released it over a year later, partly because Pete Tong campaigned for it, and partly because it was just growing in people's record bags. It was being requested, people started to recognise it, it started to connect, but like everything with Faithless, it certainly wasn't, you know, it didn't land in our laps, it took a long time. So we started playing live because we couldn't really get arrested. We got our first album out, Reverence, and nobody knew about it. Insomnia was still growing in the dance community, like DJs knew about it, but it hadn't hit critical mass. It wasn't on the radio. It was starting to grow as a record in Europe. So really we put a band together to showcase the album. And we learnt very early on, because the album was so eclectic, if we didn't put Insomnia early in the set, people would think that they'd come to see the wrong band. So yeah, we used to play Insomnia twice. So people knew they'd come to see the right band, then they could relax and we could carry on playing music that was maybe a bit more uncompromising to your average dance fan. And then we'd always play Insomnia again at the end. So we had, the world's biggest DJ, pretty much at the time, rest in peace, Avicii remixed Insomnia. And it's very interesting because his audience was much more of a streaming generation. And we've sort of come full circle in a way, because we're just about to put out our first album into the streaming world, which we've never done before. So it's an interesting time, but that remix, I think the streaming overtook the original. So, you know, it connected with a whole new fan base that weren't even born when we started, which was sort of the point of the exercise, really, in a way.